Good afternoon and welcome to the August webinar of the Smart Grid Educational Series. I'm the moderator, Erfan Ibrahim, and with us we have RMHayes today from RMHayes LLC, who's going to be talking about how to design your smart grid technology testbed. This webinar is a preview of a two-day workshop that RMHayes has put together that we're offering through the CITER Energy Academy, and it is currently being offered through the Penn State GridStar facility at the Philadelphia Navy Yard. And when I send you the recording of this presentation and the slides, I will also send you a link where you can register for that two-day workshop. And that is going to occur in February of 2014. If you would like to have this two-day workshop occur on site, it can be scheduled at a time of mutual convenience between the instructor and your facility. But minimally, we are at least offering this at Penn State at the Philadelphia Navy Yard as part of the GridStar activities over the next year. I have had the privilege of working with RMHayes for the past 5 years. When Ray was working at the American Electric Power, he was one of our advisors in the EPRI IntelliGrid program. So I've had the opportunity of exchanging ideas with him on smart grid for the past 5 years. And he was also very active in the NIST interoperability roadmap project, in which EPRI completed the phase one and organized the two workshops. Over the past several years, RMHayes has been working very effectively with American Electric Power, and then after his retirement on his own as a consultant, in developing some standards on testing smart grid technologies. As you know, there is tremendous variability on different technologies. There are a lot of proprietary technologies with protocols, and it's very difficult to test them in a consistent manner. So there has been a need to develop a test bed and have standard procedures to reduce the amount of variability in testing the same technology and same protocol by two or more entities. So we're really privileged to have an expert in our midst who's going to guide us through some of the basic building blocks of putting such a testbed together, and then being able to use this testbed repeatedly for a variety of technologies and use cases. So I would like to welcome at this time RMHayes. Ray, the floor is yours, and I will pass the presenter ball to you at this time.
Thank you, Erfan. As Erfan mentioned, I spent the bulk of my career with American Electric Power in 32 years in different R&D capacities. The last 11 years were spent at AEP's Dolan Technology Center, where I had the opportunity to establish AEP's GridSmart test beds. These were a set of 10 different test beds on various aspects of AEP's efforts in the smart grid. Also had the chance to co-manage AEP's interoperability test program that was funded by the ARRA stimulus funds. So in that last 10 years or so with the company, I had a fair amount of opportunity to work in a laboratory setting, interact with Erfan and with EPRI and a number of other R&D organizations that support the utilities. Okay, that said, we're going to take a look at a few topics we'll go through today. First, I want to define some terms so we have a little bit of a common basis of understanding. I'm going to go through the use of use cases to describe the several uses for a test bed. And we'll see, we'll look at a methodology. Since I've retired, I've had the chance to work on several different utility and government laboratories in putting together test facilities for them. And this method has been very functional in a project actually completed and on the floor. We'll look at extracting requirements. So the basis for building a laboratory is to understand the requirements you're trying to meet And the use cases are one way that we can generate that list of requirements. We're also then going to identify what features need to be present in the lab that will support the requirements. And when we talk about features, we're talking about instruments, equipment, fixtures, resources, and staffing that we're going to need to operate the lab. From there, we'll look at a neat technique for mapping the features of the lab to the intended uses. And that'll help us come up with a way to budget the capital expense of the laboratory, how to put the lab together as an equipment. Test plans are a way we can actually codify the process of testing vendor equipment. And then we'll take a look at some standard operating procedures, which are a way to hard code processes, but then also maintain them in a living library. All right, so the first definition, just get a hand at what we mean by smart grid. And really the smart grid is more of a vision than it is a particular thing. The National Energy Testing Laboratories have identified six characteristics for smart grid. And we'll go through those and then we'll take a look at what each of them means. But basically the grid will enable active customer participation. It will accommodate new generation and storage options. Will enable new products, services, and options. Provide power quality for the digital economy. Will optimize asset utilization and efficiency, and it will be resilient against human and natural attack. So when we're looking at the smart grid, these are basically the types of things that we're trying to do the existing grid to bring it up into the 21st century. The smart grid technologies we'll be looking at basically. We can identify a group of equipment that fits each one of those six characteristics. There'll be customer-facing equipment that we have to deal with, which are things like home area networking, messaging systems, for control, for pricing, for customer messaging, direct control capabilities, and then a number of utilities have established web portals that allow the customer to get very timely information and to provide changes in his service or get messages from the utility. Customer side generation and energy storage, there's been an explosion in renewables in this administration. We haven't seen too much lately in battery storage technology. Backup generation, of course, has been very popular in the last few years, trying to avoid long-term outages from their storms. Net metering, if you've been following the news in California at all, has had a little bit of activity around it, especially in terms of mixing renewables, which can be reimbursed on net metering, compared to battery storage, which is not really reimbursable under net metering. Looking at new offerings, new service offerings, the prepay, different time-based tariffs. The time of day tariffs for the utility guys or the non-utility guys are tariffs that change twice or more per year. So there's a fixed rate for a certain part of the day, then it changes from a higher rate to a lower rate during the off-peak times. And that's in place for months at a time and then changes. Critical peak pricing is similar in that it has fixed rates that are in place throughout the year, but the grid is able to signal that there's a critical resource need on the grid. So we're talking about a TOD rate, which maybe go from 6 to 9 cents per kilowatt hour from its low to its high rate, into a CPP, a critical peak pricing, which may go up into 75 cents or more per kilowatt hour during the critical time. Real pricing, the first real-time pricing tariff that AEP supported was for Steel Dynamics in Indiana, and that was an hourly change in the price of electricity, so that Steel Dynamics could vary their manufacturing schedule to take advantage of lower prices, or they could reflect the cost of higher priced energy into the cost of the product that they're manufacturing. For the digital age, we're looking at PQ enhancements on the grid, which give us better ways to control voltage, the volt bar control optimizations, which basically are looking to hold the voltage steady from the substation out to the end of the circuit. Distribution automation, which is allowing us to isolate faults in the circuit. to communicate with devices at the field that we'll open a couple of switches or will some other way help to maintain grid. And then harmonics and flicker mitigation. We had little problems in the distribution space where we were serving some kind of very nasty loads, welding shops or arc furnace shops where they can have a pretty negative impact on the voltage quality that the customers around them see. Self-healing, again, is around being able to isolate faults, to quick clear them, to reroute power around them. Theft detection. Hot socket has become a pretty popular topic recently, and if those of you who aren't familiar with that, the picture on the right here is a picture of some old new sockets. And very often those sockets were placed on a residence or on a commercial building when it was first built. And maybe the meter was installed at the time, and at that time those sockets were very strong and clean, and it takes a real matter of force to push the meter into the socket. When we go through an AMI episode, you know, we're not using usually meter electricians to change out those meters and put the new AMI meters in. We're doing it with a migrant labor force that moves from utility to utility, and they change 5,000 to 8,000 meters per day. So they don't maybe pay quite as much attention to the quality of the socket. When they pull the old meter out, those sockets have gotten sticky and they're corroded or they've been overheated and loosened up. The new meter going in bends the socket a little bit and winds with a bad connection and an overheat that can result in a fire. So the ability to detect that through your AMI system, through a smart meter, can be very beneficial to the utility. And then for resilience to human and cyber attack, there's a lot of activity around cyber security, but also around, again, the self-healing ability of the grid to resist a human problem, a car crash, fall, that kind of thing. Okay. I'm not seeing. I'll move forward. Irfan, any ideas?
Yeah, just hold on a second. It might just be a network delay.
Okay.
I'm seeing slide 3 already on definition smart with the 6.
Right, I'm trying to move forward from slide 3, and looks like I'm stuck.
Okay, so go back one slide. It just might be an issue of it's not refreshing on your screen. Because I see myself on slide 3 with you right now.
Right, and I'm moving back from, I just hit the back button to slide. Should have gone to slide 2, but had no action. Forward button to slide 4 has no action.
Okay, let me take back the presenter ball and see if I can make a difference.
Thanks.
So that was slide 4?
That's slide 4.
Slide 5.
Okay. Okay, thank you. Do I have the control again?
If you like, I can move the slides for you.
Okay, let's do that.
Okay.
All right, so we'll take a look, and we're looking at some definitions here. What do we mean by a test bed? Well, a test bed is a place that's equipped with instrumentation to measure equipment that's in service. And this concept was originally formed around the aerodynamics industry where we can model, but it's very difficult to accurately model the complexity of an aircraft engine. So the test beds would be either a laboratory or an actual aircraft that would be flown full of instrumentation and to determine how the system was working. We have a similar concept, but for the smart grid test bed, we're going to say that this is the assembly of a set of test features that are needed to verify smart grid technology before it's deployed in the field. So for the most part, we're looking at testing of equipment that came from a vendor, but we want to catch it before it goes into the field and verify that we understand how it works. It also gives us the opportunity to establish some training facilities for people that will work out in the field so they can come into the test bed and play with equipment and see how it's expected to work, make sure they know what they're doing before they go out to the field. Okay, next slide. Different types of testing we're going to address in the test beds. There are three basic types of testing for smart grid equipment. Functional testing deals with the device being able to carry out its basic function. So, for instance, a programmable communicating thermostat has a basic function, which is to control the temperature in a space. The functionality of the device really doesn't depend on its ability to operate in the smart grid. The basic functionality is to do HVAC control. So functional testing will look at, for instance, a thermostat's ability to hold temperature, or maybe secondarily its ability to manage an interface with the user, so the user can go through and do time of day programming or change the temperature set points. The second type is compliance testing. So there are a lot of standards and specifications that have been spun out to support the smart grid, and many of the vendors will claim that their device complies to a certain called out standard. Compliance testing so will involve the execution of a bunch of tests that will determine that this device actually does comply as claimed. One of the pieces that may not be quite familiar to a lot of people is the PICS that's associated with compliance testing. That's the Protocol Implementation Conformance Statement. And basically when a device is sent for compliance testing to a laboratory, it'll be sent with a checklist of possible protocol functions that it supports. So for instance, in a Zigbee device, it might support time of day setting, customer messaging, setting prices, or controlling temperatures. It may be that the vendor has not specified that it be tested for load control functions. In that case, it can still be certified as compliant. However, it does not support the particular function that you might expect it to because it's a Zigbee thermostat or whatever other device you're looking at. So the PICS is something that the laboratory needs to be familiar with and able to call on and make sure that when they're testing a device, they are testing it for things that it's expected to be able to do and not testing beyond its claimed capabilities. The third type is interoperability, and that has to do with the device's ability to work within the rest of the environment that it's placed in. So if we've got a meter from one vendor and we've got a thermostat from a second vendor, we need to verify that the meter is able to issue a command to the thermostat, and the thermostat can correctly interpret that and respond. And that applies, of course, not only in the hand, but also out on the distribution feeder where we may have a SCADA system trying to issue a command through an RTU down into a recloser control or up in the generation side. So all throughout the system, this interoperability has to do with these devices being able to work together with other systems that they're placed into. And across all three of those falls the concept of regression testing. So regression testing is when we've identified an issue that we'd like a vendor to correct. The vendors usually are very fast for utility. They'll turn a correction around in several days. But we're not sure yet that they haven't broken some other part of the system that was already working. So regression testing will run through a sequence of tests, a test plan, to re-verify that a device is in an acceptable condition or to identify more bugs that have to be fed back and corrected. Okay, next slide, Irvin. Use case is a methodology used in system analysis to identify, clarify, and organize system requirements. The use cases that I've worked with are based on the IntelliGrid use case template that was created by Enernex and EPRI together and is applied to trying to dig out the details needed to automate a system that previously has been performed manually. In our case, we're going to use the use case to flesh out the functions that we want to be able to execute inside of our testbed. So the use case, we'll develop one use case for each one of the uses that we expect to put this lab into. Go ahead and hurry for the next slide. So basic information, the IntelliGrid template is an available template online. Anyone can get a hold of it. It's broken up into three sections. The first section collects basic information, and of those, the most important is 1.4, the narrative section. So the narrative is an explanation of the job that we want to have done, but it's in the language of the domain expert. Very often, use cases have been used to develop automation of manual systems, but the people writing the automation are computer literate, database literate, so they think in terms of records, fields, databases, and transactions of servers and clients, where the domain expert has a whole different set of language. For instance, if we're automating a bank process, which is kind of a classical case, rather than a client and a server, we might have a customer and a teller. Rather than a database record, we have a cash drawer. Rather than a transaction, we might have a deposit or a withdrawal slip. So the narrative is generated in the language of the people that are familiar with this process. From the narrative, we can extract what are called actors. So an actor not only are the humans that are involved in this process, but it includes any instrumentation, any fixtures, any resources that get used in the process of executing this process. The information exchange, for instance, the details on a deposit or withdrawal slip, we specifically identify what information we're trying to exchange so that we don't wind up developing a system that is really not compatible with what the customer expected to see. Activities and services performed, in one case might be the transaction of a withdrawal or a deposit. Maybe on the computer side of that's a database transaction that does a debit or a credit. And then the contracts and regulations. So like a banker may have a requirement that a customer have an account before he can cash a check. There are related contracts and regulations that have to do with how we interact with the vendors of new equipment so that we wind up with a win-win situation. We want to have a better product that we can deploy in the field. The vendor would like to have a better product that he can make available on the market. Okay, next slide. The second part of the IntelliGrid use case template is documenting the step-by-step procedure that's involved in going through this process. So we'll collect step-by-step operations. Each operation will look at a precondition and assumption. We'll look at the normal step-by-step process, so one step after another. The template allows for parallel execution. So if there's, for instance, two things going on in parallel, we have a numbering scheme to deal with that. We look at alternatives and exception sequences. So if we had something that shouldn't have happened occur, there is a way to document how to proceed from that point. And then we'll look at the post conditions and results. And in the case of testing, very often the result is a pass or a fail condition. Architectural issues and interactions and descriptive drawings are ways to better understand how everything fits together and what all parts are involved in what we're trying to do. Go ahead, next slide, Irvin. The information we capture on each step. Now, this is the standard set of columns from IntelliGrid, a step number and a triggering event. So an event that causes this step to actually execute. Who's the primary actor involved? The activity name and description, the sources of information, the absorbers of information, the type of information exchanged. Go ahead, next slide. Now, in addition, we're going to pad out the IntelliGrid use case step by step to pick up a few extra pieces of information that are critical to laboratory design. Those will include, in this step, any instrumentation that was needed. And by instrumentation, we mean meters, scopes, measuring devices, power supplies, signal generators, any kind of fixture. So a fixture would be, for instance, a stand or a clamp, a bench space, consumables, such as forms we're filling out, chemicals that we're consuming, packaging materials, resources. So resources will be the supply of voltage and current that we need to operate this test. Any compressed air, washing water, or cooling water, or any other resource that would have to be a fundamental part of the test bed to execute the test. And then we'll look at staffing time and the skills that our staff should have. Okay, next. This is a sample drawing from a test bed that we've done for another utility. And you can see above the kind of that green wall here is outside of the lab. Below the green wall is inside the lab. And this was an interoperability test bed for home area networking equipment. So you can kind of get the idea that there's a flow of information based on the direction of the arrows. We have some manpower staffing. We have some interface up into our AMI system, which feeds out through the cell network and comes back in. The cell network is what's issuing commands down into the AMI meters, the smart meters. You can see in this case that it's talking to a cell relay. So this is an Itron house that we were building this test bed for. The cell relay is feeding, so we've got some kind of some blue communications coming from the cell tower. We've got some red between the cell relay and the smart meter. And then we've got some yellow, which is the Zigbee network going off into a load control switch, an in-home display, or a thermostat, or whatever other home area network equipment to be tested. In addition, we're going off on the yellow wireless up into a hand sniffer. So we're identifying at this point that we have certain configuration requirements. We need to have all this equipment mounted in some place. We need to be able to sniff the signals. And we also need to be able to communicate with the AMI head end. Okay, go ahead, Nurkin. So the third section in the IntelliGrid use case is the auxiliary issues. So the auxiliaries pick up the references and contacts. Who is it that we're working with to develop this use case and any documents that we're going to refer to in its execution. Action item list. So this is for building the use case and if we're issuing action items as we go. And then the revision history. It may take several revisions. Usually the use case, data can be collected in the first day or half a day even. It's written up usually within a day or two from there, and then it's fed back into the domain experts for comment. So this is similar to how we would put together the test bed use case, is that we would interview maybe the vendors and the users, the executors of the lab. We generate this use case, and the use case would identify one use of the test bed, feed that back, get some corrections, and work our way around. But to be useful, we really need the use case to stabilize within the first week or two of this process. Okay, next, Irvin. So the next step, once we have a use case together, is how do we extract the requirements for the test bed from that use case? So we have one use case to describe one use in the test bed. Part of the use case was the step-by-step process. And if you remember, we put in the additional information that identified instrumentation, fixtures, consumable, resources, and staff. I found it's useful a lot of times to put kind of a pseudocode step-by-step into the narrative itself so that, again, working back with the domain expert in his language, he can read through a simple do this, then do this, then do this. And feedback if that actually is how it happens or if there's some corrections that need to be made there. All right, go ahead, next slide. Now, a lot of times we're going to be working with new equipment from a vendor and the customer may not quite know how the device is going to work. We have to go back into the specifications for the device to figure out how we're going to put together this test in the test bed. So the requirements can be based on the device under test specification. And again, we're looking for functional compliance and interoperability test needs. It's a little hard to see. This is a small slide, but this is from an actual end-of-line voltage sensor that's intended for volt bar control applications. The vendor has put together physical, environmental. You can see here has identified some environmental compliance standards. In our laboratories, we typically would not retest for compliance if a certified laboratory has already tested the compliance. but it does require a review of those tests. Very often, the compliance test will have, especially these environmental compatibility tests, will have several levels that they can be tested at. So there may be a 1 kV version of a dielectric test that would get the device through a certification lab, but our utilities typically require, let's say, a 4 kV dielectric strength to be able to put a device in the field. So even though it was tested in a compliance lab, it wasn't tested at the levels that we require to apply the equipment. But very often the compliance tests are sufficient, and we can just put them in the file and accept the tests that were done by an outside laboratory. One thing you notice over here on the communications, this vendor put information about the serial ports, the WAN radio, the frequencies they operate. There's nothing here about protocol. There's information about measured I/O, for instance, that there are 3 analog inputs, but there's nothing about precision. So the specification is not the end of our search for what it is we need to test. Go to the next slide. So this is going a little further into the brochure on that same device, and they have a section in there called the features of the device under test. And I just highlighted a few of them here, but inputs, 3 inputs at 0.3% accuracy class. Well, that's a pretty important specification. Why that didn't go into the specification section, I'm not sure. But that tells us that we have certain requirements of measurement accuracy, of signal generation, so that we can actually provide a signal. We can take a measurement from the device and we can compare it to a measurement that we derive independently. It tells us something about the voltage levels that this device is expecting to see in its measurement, so we know, again, a little bit about what we need to be able to generate that signal. The next section here, this is a DNP3 outstation. Now, it said other places that this is a DNP level 1 outstation. DNP is able to identify 4 different levels of operation. Level 1 is the simplest, the smallest subset of functions, and basically would be a simple sensor that can report back when polled with some information. It wouldn't generate exceptions. It wouldn't do anything fancy. But right next to that, the vendor says the DNP3 outstation includes unsolicited response. Well, that's a pretty important specification as well. Unsolicited response means that if the device has had some kind of an event, and in this case it was that it exceeded a dead band or it exceeded a threshold value, that it will initiate a message to the master on its own. That's critical because, one thing, it has to make some very intelligent decisions in the process of doing that we need to provide. Another is that it can dramatically reduce the communication overhead on our network, so we need to verify that that is a viable function. The third here is that it reports true RMS voltage and current plus a bunch of other things. So this is telling us in a piece that wasn't provided in the specification that there are things that we need to be able to be ready to test if we're going to bring a device like this into our test bed for verification. Okay, perfect. All right, so the next step here, we went through our use cases. We identified the uses of the lab. We used the uses of the lab to identify a set of requirements that need to be met. The next piece that we have to do is determine what features do we need in the lab that will satisfy those requirements. So the smart grid technology test bed, it's the assembly of test features needed to verify smart grid technology before it's deployed in the field. So the real basis of the design of the lab is to figure out what features need to be in the lab so that we can carry out the set of tests that we expect to carry out. The requirements we have may often overlap, and maybe multiple requirements can be satisfied by single feature. For example, if we need a true RMS AC voltage, we may be able to get that from a digital voltmeter or a benchtop voltmeter. In another case, we need to capture a waveform, we may need a digital oscilloscope. Right? To be able to take the digital oscilloscope and upgrade it so that it can provide the true RMS AC voltmeter function and reduce desk space and maybe reduce expense in the capital cost of our lab. When we're looking at staffing, human intervention may be required in several steps, but they may not always be the same kind of human intervention. For instance, there may be a forklift operator that's needed to move a piece of equipment around, but there may be a technician needed to take measurements, and there may be an engineer needed to do some statistical analysis and come to the conclusion. So while we can sometimes overlap the functions in the technicians that work in the test bed, sometimes we can't. So we assemble common denominators, and we create a set of test bed features that have to be available so that we can carry out the planned uses of the test bed. All right, next slide, Murphy. So we're going to map our features to our uses. We have a set of uses, and each one establishes one or more requirements. So we can have a one-to-many relationship between uses and requirements. Each requirement may be satisfied by one or more features. Hopefully, one feature will satisfy our requirement, but one feature may also satisfy more than one of our requirements. And each feature can be provided in one of several ways. So we may be able to take a voltage measurement with device A, but we can also take it with device B. Each of these features will incur some expense in the laboratory. So whatever we're going to put into this lab, somebody's going to have to pay for. We have a capital expense that we'd like to minimize but still maintain functionality. And then each of these features may support multiple of our requirements. Next slide, Irfan. So we have a kind of a complicated arrangement of uses with a one-to-many for requirements, features with a one-to-many into requirements. We also have requirements that can back up one-to-many into uses and requirements that can push out one-to-many into features. So it gets to be a really complicated mapping among all three of them. But if we eliminate the requirements part in this mapping, it actually gets pretty simple. Now we're down to, we have a list of uses, and in this table we've got uses number 1 through 6. And we have a list of features, and we've mapped in feature 1 through 6. We can see here that use number 1 requires feature number 1 and number 4 to execute it. Use number 2 requires all 6 of the features. Feature number 2 supports uses number 2, 3, and 4. Feature number 4 supports every one of our 6 uses. So we can see if, from this table, just kind of by eye, we can see easily that if we eliminated feature number 6, we could still do all our uses except number 2. And in fact, once we've eliminated number 6, we might as well eliminate number 5 because we can't do number 2 anyway. So we may maybe eliminate, or maybe we just delay the purchase of it. But this is a management decision. Do we want, is use number 2 important enough to us to maybe incur a $20,000 or $30,000 expense to install feature number 6? On the other hand, feature number 4 is used in every one of our uses. So if we eliminate feature number 4, the test bed goes away. We have no functions that it can provide. So we would say number 4 essentially is a given. And that might be something like the electric power infrastructure in the laboratory that everybody, you know, all tests are going to need, so there's no choice of not putting it in. Feature number 6 might be a high cost, let's say a $20,000 environmental chamber that lets us do this one test number 2, but maybe we can delay that expense and do test number 2 another time, or send it outside to be done at another laboratory. Okay, next slide. So this is that same mapping that was done for one of the actual laboratories we did for NIST. And what you can see in this case, we're looking at the ANSI C12.1 set of tests. There are 38 tests in ANSI C12.1. Those are tests that are performed on a revenue grade meter to verify its ability to operate under high and low temperatures, under fault conditions to survive a fault, under high radio emission levels. So there's a whole big suite of tests that I use to verify the quality of a revenue grade meter. C12.20 is the updated version of that for electronic rather than electromagnetic meters. What you can see here is there is one of these features in column M. This is a set of devices for calibrating meters. So there's a WECO test set. The test set comes with two standards, a working standard and a master standard. The working standard is inside of the test set, So it's the one that's used on a day-by-day basis. The master standard is kept in a closet and is used to come back and do calibration checks. You can see over here, if we want to calibrate the standards themselves, one of the processes for doing that is to put it in a box and ship it back to a calibration house to be tested. All right, so this feature in column M is actually the case that's used to ship those standards back to the manufacturer. And if we turn off that feature, so we've saved $340 in the cost of this laboratory, so it knocked down the capital cost a little bit, but it prevents us from doing two of these tests. So these first two tests, the calibration of the internal standard and the external standard, are not going to be able to be done because we don't have one of the devices needed to do that test. If I check this, that would turn these to trues, we'd be able to do these tests, and it would increase the cost for the laboratory by $340. So at this point, we're looking at a list of features that we're going to decide, do we want to actually install these right now? If we do want everything turned on, we'll turn it all on, and we'll get an estimate of what the cost will be to install it. Excuse me. If some pieces are too expensive, as I said, we had $20,000 environmental chamber. We also had a $60,000 surge generator for testing current surges through a meter. Well, that test can be done in almost any other meter test facility, so why don't we just forget about that $60,000 piece of equipment and instead, when it comes to that test, if we have to do it, if it hasn't already been certified by another lab, we'll send it to a lab to have that done. All right, so this is a way to trade off cost for functionality in the test bed. Okay, next. The way to get a consistent set of results and a nicely reportable set of results is to create a test plan that goes along with the devices that you're trying to test. Test plans are the way that we handle them at Dolan Lab, and it seems to be a good way to do it, is to use pieces of software that have been developed for software development and testing. We used HP's Quality Center, and it bases its test plan starting with a requirement. So we have a requirement to do a certain type of verification of a device. That requirement will bring in several scenarios, one scenario. But the scenario is a combination of an input and a set of preconditions that define the state of the system and what we do to it to test it. We then generate some test cases. So each one of these combinations of input and preconditions will generate an expected output and post condition and a pass-fail condition. So if we take all these combinations of scenarios, we'll take just a quick look at what that looks like in a minute. We put those together. We generate a set of test sets, a set of test cases. That's called the test set, and it basically uses the same test script but with different preconditions and postconditions to run through a sequence of variable environments that this device might be in when it's put through this test. All right, go to the next slide. So an example, let's say we're looking at this end-of-line sensor. And some of the features we've identified of this sensor that need to be tested. It's a DMP level 1 outstation. It supports unsolicited response for a dead band exception. It's able to measure RMS voltage within 1 volt RMS at a 120 volt nominal within a given temperature span. It has a 30 dB transmit capability on its radio. 30 dB means 1 watt of transmit capability. And it's got a receive sensitivity of minus 90 dBm, which means basically 1 billionth of a milliwatt is enough signal for it to receive. All right, go ahead, Eric, on the next slide. So the test case we're going to look at is to verify the unsolicited response to configurable deadband. Now this is only one type of a test that we're looking to execute. There could be many more. For instance, if this is a DNP device, we would want to test that it's able to respond to an integrity poll. We may want to verify that it can do class 1, class 2, class 3 responses. In this case, we're looking at a deadband exception. So we have a precondition that we're going to set, and in this case, the precondition scenario is that we have a dead band set to 2 volts RMS. So if we have a change from our previously reported value by 2 volts or more, we're going to generate an unsolicited response. In this case, we're saying the previous measurement that was reported is 118 volts RMS, and that device is configured to send an unsolicited response to the master. The post condition is we're still going to have the 2 volt RMS dead band. We're going to have some kind of a measurement that's come out that will be between 115 and 116 volts, right? So we were at 118, we set a 2 volt dead band. If we were at 118 and we slowly ramped it down from 118 to 115, the device will probably kick up at 116 and make the report, even though we still continue down to 115. If we quickly transition from 118 to 115, the device will probably just see 115 and report that back. And then the output we expect is an unsolicited response to the master using DMP3. All right, next. Now, that scenario was just one case. We could have tested that the voltage jumped instead to 115, it jumped up to 125. In that case, we should see a different scenario of inputs. Precondition is the same, the input is different, the change in voltage. The expected response is different. But it's the exact same test sequence that gets used. So this test set will be a set of these tests that use different input and precondition, but use the same set of steps that we go through to take those tests. The steps are called the test script. Okay, next. So the script is the assembled test set. The assembled test set has a particular test script associated with it, and that script tells us step-by-step what to do. The scenario tells us the input and the precondition, and then also the output and the postcondition. Go ahead, next version. And then the test plan will be the assembled set of test cases that apply to this particular device that we're trying to test. So we just looked at one particular test set which had to do with an unsolicited response to a dead band exception. We'd have also a test around a response to an integrity pole. We might have a test around a response to a cycle of power, right? So power went out and came back. How does this device come back and reestablish itself? So that assembly is our test plan. In a package like HP Quality Center, we'll start by defining the requirement of the test, and then we'll flesh out each one of these scenarios and the test script, and then assemble them into a test set. And then we'll have a place in HP Quality Center to execute the test, to collect the results, and to generate a report on a pass-fail condition for this particular device. Okay, go ahead, next. So when we get in the laboratory setting, the number one concern for all utilities is employee safety. The standard operating procedure is a prescribed procedure to be followed routinely, right? That's the definition of it. In our cases, the SOP is a control document describing safe and effective execution of a procedure and prescribing training, certification, and procedure review periods required of staff. So, for instance, in your test bed, you have a number of uses. There are going to be a number of tests that you're going to execute. There aren't only tests. There are also procedures like setup and cleanup. There are procedures like maybe soldering or welding. There might be lifting procedures for heavy items. Packaging procedures for devices coming in and going out of your facility. Each one of those can be codified into a standard operating procedure. The idea of the procedure, go ahead to the next slide. Perfect. The procedure is, the idea is to give us a way to execute our test procedures safe and effectively, right? There's risk personnel. We could possibly have risk of damage to equipment. We could have a health risk to personnel. We could have damage to the devices that we're trying to test. So we want to carefully develop the SOPs so we minimize that risk and optimize performance in the test bed. The SOPs have to be a living document. So they have to be reviewed periodically. For one thing, tests may be executed once a year, and we forget the details of it. So there'll be a prescribed refresh period. It might even be a prescription to reread the SOP every time you do this test. That may not be necessary for a test that's run once a day or once a week, but you can see it would be valuable for a test run once a year. In addition, we need to review the procedure itself. So if the procedure included the use of a particular piece of equipment, and that equipment is no longer available, it's been replaced, it's been updated, we need to go back and refresh the SOP so that our staff are working with current documents and are able to continue to do an effective job. All right, next. In the outline of the SOP is a kind of a standard document used in laboratories. And the one that I use, it's got eight sections to it. Most of them you can see are pretty clear. We pick up the purpose, the scope, definition, and references within this operation. Responsibility, so who's the writer of the SOP, who's reviewing it, who's the maintainer of the SOP, so go back and make sure that it's always current, and who's the record keeper, so who's keeping track of who's gone through and been certified and whose certification time is coming up and they have to be recertified. The third section is how the SOP is supposed to be trained, so maybe a classroom setting, might be in a laboratory, could be out in the field, on site, whatever is suitable for this SOP. The procedures that are to be followed in the SOP, so there may be the step-by-step procedure that we develop through the use case, documentation of the test harness that's to be used, the assembly of equipment to be able to do this one test, what parameters are involved in setting the test, whatever is the right level of detail for the procedure that we're trying to document. Hazards and mitigation, so it may be, and that this may be particularly a live section of the document where in the process of running these tests, we've identified an activity that might be a little bit risky, so we're going to make sure that the operator is familiar with that and understands how to do it safely. Quality assurance is making sure that we capture the data that's generated and put it into a format that it can actually be used reliably. Qualification and requalification, so the SOP contains within itself the instructions for how an operator can be qualified to perform this procedure and requalified as the time comes up, and then how to go back and review the SOP itself to make sure that it stays current. Okay, next slide. So this is a basic outline of the design of the test bed. What it really didn't address too much is the operation itself of the test bed. We went through basically looking at the cost of building this test bed, what has to go into it. So that's, you can think of it as a capital expense. But anyone who's run a lab knows that the operating expense is actually the greater part of a lab expense. So one of the things we'll be looking at in this workshop is budgeting to run a test bed. The staffing requirements, so how do you identify what skill set is needed? Do you have the people in-house or should you be going outside for it? Training personnel to work in the test bed. So the SOPs are a great training tool, but there may be other facilities. Besides the SOPs, though, we may also be training our field personnel. So we may have linemen coming in to see how to configure a recloser control, or a telecom guy coming in to see if there's a communications hiccup, how does this thing act, and how do I know how to fix it. We have to maintain the features of the lab, so there'll be things like calibration intervals, there'll be, any kind of work that has to be done to keep the equipment in operating condition. Team address to addressing issues, team approach. Usually a test bed or a laboratory is going to be staffed by technicians or engineers, and these technical people tend to think procedurally. So when they're given a problem and asked to come up with a solution, very often the solution is mapped out within a few minutes in their mind, and then they start figuring out how to actually execute that map. That leads very often to some tunnel vision. So by taking a team approach where we can propose a design and then we can go through design reviews and get feedback from multiple people, we almost always can get a better design than if we just handed it to one guy and told him to run with it. The infrastructure requirements. So how do we establish how much floor space we need, electrical, mechanical, and communication needs? on the floor plan. Do we want to isolate the space to a particular function, or do we want to share the space among multiple functions in the lab? At AEP Dolan, we did quite a bit of sharing of the space. In other labs that I've seen, they intentionally put isolation barriers between the different functions of the test bed. By putting those isolation barriers, it's almost like going to a mass production mode where it's typically a more efficient process. You always have your equipment in place, it's configured, the test harnesses are ready, the space is always available for your use because you're the only one that uses it. So it requires greater resources, but it could, with a high volume laboratory, increase your throughput. The shared spaces, though, require scheduling and use of the equipment of the space, breaking down and then reassembling test harnesses. So it takes a little bit more time, but it reduces the resources needed to get the test bed established and to keep it operating. So that's kind of a decision on the part of the builder of the lab. Reporting your work to management. So it's important to make sure that your work is valued. Laboratories, a lot of times, think of themselves as the first thing to be cut. In most organizations, R&D is one of the highest return on investments that you can get. But it looks like it doesn't directly affect the bottom line because you're not serving customers or you're not participating in management meetings very often. So getting your work in front of management in a way that they can understand it is an important part of a laboratory operation. Soliciting new internal clients. If you're building a test bed, it's usually being built for one particular section. It might be the distribution operations want something around this distribution automation, or it might be the metering people would like to see something about AMI, or it might be customer service wants to see the home area network. Those are great candidates, but you can also go out and find other candidates in the company, usually especially in the utility company, a vertically oriented utility, that can take advantage of the space and make greater use of it and then provide greater value for your services. And the last thing that you really need to consider and not discourage is hosting visitors to the test bed. The original test beds probably didn't have a lot of visitors, testing a jet engine on a bench or in an aircraft. There might be a few managers that would come through to see what's going on, but that's about it. But when you build a smart grid test bed, that's a different story. For one thing, the concept of what a smart grid is not that clear to a lot of people, even to utility people. So we very often had visitors coming down from headquarters. We had from the highest level of management, our CEO, who would come down and use the test bed for television interviews. We had Stephen Chu, the Secretary of Energy, down at our test bed to present our ARRA demonstration grants. So from the highest level of management to trainees and interns who are just trying to understand, what is the next coming thing on the power grid, down to high school and grade school students, who are looking for a great opportunity to have a field trip and absorb something that they haven't seen before and that can make a connection maybe between the utility and their own family. I had hosted probably over 1,000 people a year when I was operating the gridSmart test bed. Again, running from upper management through any section engineers to interns down to students coming in. The one thing you might want to think about is scheduling a time in the test bed when you make those available, maybe one day a week. Some of the visitors we had in were so many of them and they were so involved that we might have to shut down the rest of the lab just to accommodate them. So if you can hold that to one day a week, let's say, that makes it a lot easier on your operation side, and it also makes it easier on your visitor side that you can actually schedule and execute very good tours of your facilities. Okay, Irfan, that's the end of my slide. So if there are any questions, I'd be glad to try to answer them.
Yes, thank you, Ray. And as people post their questions, I'd like to share some of my observations on this presentation and generally on this topic. One thing that I've always admired about you, Ray, is that you're able to capture the big picture but also come down to very specific things that makes it real for people. And that's a very rare quality in our industry, and you have it. You also have a very strong intuitive side to you that can anticipate issues, and you start working on it well before other people do. So I really commend you on your innovation and your creativity and your ability to articulate very complex things in very simple ways. The value, the true value of this test bed, and ultimately the ability to move from an innovation in smart grid to an invention with commercial deployment, is the need to connect two areas that today are very disconnected. There is a top-down approach with use cases that's coming up with a set of requirements, and then there's a bottoms-up approach of doing testing at the component level and then putting components together to build systems. And what the test bed for smart grid does is it helps lock the two approaches together into a very structured process by which you can take the high-level requirements and distill them down to the primitive requirements as Marty Burns and others have done through the tree requirements metrics, and then have this test bed where you can start doing tests that have an economic significance to both the utility and the customer. And through the templates that you've shared with us, Ray, you're showing a very structured way of deciding which tests to do, what order to do them in to have maximum impact. So I think that for the listeners, this is very important that if you don't have such a methodology in place at your facility and you're thinking of deploying smart grid technologies, it's really important that you look at this procedure in detail and understand all the subtle nuances and develop this process internally so that you have very little variability, you are able to validate the results from other locations, and you provide vendors a consistent model to evaluate their technologies as opposed to looking at it haphazardly and developing anecdotal evidence for or against a particular technology. So at this point, I'd like to open it up and have Ray, if you want to respond to any of my comments as we wait for questions.
Well, I appreciate the words. Arf, very kind. And as you said, it is important to work from both ends. We're looking at how does the utility want to apply smart grid technology on the top end. On the bottom end, we have to look at what's actually available and out there to put it into service. And, the ability to feedback useful information to the vendors can be very powerful. It was very, very likely when we got a piece of new equipment that there was some issue that had to be fixed in it. So, we did get quite a bit of value, I think, out of the test beds that we established at Dolan.
Great. I don't see any questions. I think that your presentation was quite clear and very thorough. And I'd like to remind the people online that this is actually a preview of a two-day workshop. And the purpose of the workshop is to develop the knowledge base of the attendees in the first half, and in the second half, go through some practical exercises so that the attendees have some employable skills that they can actually take the findings from this workshop and go and start building test beds of their own in their own respective areas. And this is why these workshops are so critical. And as I mentioned, when I send the presentation out with the recording, I will also give you a link by which you can register for this workshop in February if you're just an individual attendee at the Philadelphia Navy Yard at the GridStar facility. But if you are a utility or a vendor and you'd like to have this workshop on site, please reach out to me and I can arrange for Ray to come out to your facility and offer this workshop. Ray is one of our Citer Energy Academy instructors who is providing this workshop, and it's a flat fee-based workshop on site, and there is a fee for attending as an attendee in the Philadelphia Navy Yard, and I can provide all those details if you communicate with me. Okay, we have a question. In terms of scale, what is the optimum size of a typical test bed?
Uh, Well, are we talking about floor? Have we talked about floor space? It depends on whether you decided to common space or to isolate the testing into different sections. But in general, if you common the space, we were able, and I think we're very functional at it, to put roughly 1,200 square feet into service and operated probably 8 of our 10 test beds in that much space. The common space allows us to have layout space for each of the types of things we're testing. So we had, for instance, AMI, home area network, smart appliances, energy efficiency, and maybe one other test bed within the same 1,000 square foot physical space. That space right outside of it was a space for electric transportation. So we could easily get in and share the space inside if we needed to, but the electric transportation parts were actually staged outdoors. One of the laboratories I was just in recently probably had 800 square foot on each one of their isolated spaces, and they had, I believe it was 8 isolated spaces. So they might have had closer to, 6,000 to 7,000 square foot. Now, those were very isolated. They worked on one topic in one room. My observation was that most of the time, those rooms were empty. And the one room that was active, was busy. The rooms on either side of it were empty almost the whole time that I was there. So you can get much faster turnaround because your equipment is all staged and ready to go, but it's going to be at the expense of much more floor space and probably of having multiple staff to be able to staff it because they're not as familiar with the functions on either side of them. So you can say 1,200 square foot to combine and put 6-8 test beds together compared to 7,000 or 8,000 square foot to isolate them and do the same 8 different test beds.
Good. And then Dean asks, how does the NIST test framework factor in this experience?
When we did the NIST work, we were required to generate this exact design. We went through this exact design process. The test processes that were established at NIST, really the only parts that affected us were the use of their cell structure. They have a number of cells that they've established at their facility in Gaithersburg. And, since we were executing standards-based tests, the test procedures had been worked out within the C-12 standards. So other than, procurement of equipment and allocation of floor space, we weren't really subject to much in the way of restriction by NIST.
There's a comment that says DNP test example illustrates that some tests may already exist as conformance tests. It does not make sense to repeat these tests. Should spend time on tests that were not executed.
Yeah, that's completely correct. I think I made that statement, but that where conformance testing is called for, the first step is to look at what's already been documented by that vendor. So if the vendor can come in with a conformance statement that is from a registered laboratory. Now, you do have, if you remember, I made the statement that you do have to review that test and make sure that it was done at the level that your operation requires. So, for instance, if a device was tested for application inside of a university student laboratory, that's a lot different than certifying it for use on a power pole. So utilities will have their own requirements for things like dielectric strength, surge withstand, temperature extremes. So a test lab may have certified for a particular test at a lower level of stress than the utility requires. But if the test lab had tested to the required level of stress for the utility, then absolutely that test should be accepted. It shouldn't be repeated.
And then there was a follow-up comment from the person who was asked about the optimal size. They were asking in terms of equipment. not in terms of size. So do you have any comment on the equipment that should go typically in a test bed?
Well, it depends on what it is you're testing. For instance, in the home area network, there's not a lot of equipment requirement, right? We're talking about sniffers to be able to monitor the exchange on the protocols, and we're looking at some voltage sources or some signal generators to be able to produce a signal that can be taken by the device and the device can respond to. But if you're talking about distribution automation equipment, now you may have to stage much more sophisticated voltage, Omicron type of voltage sources. You may have to have more sophisticated type of waveform capture devices, digital scopes. You may need, if you're talking about radio equipment, you may need RF sniffers and spectrum analyzers. And so it really depends completely on, that's what the point of this exercise is to design the test bed to meet the needs that you anticipate in your testing. A DA test bed would be different than an electric vehicle test bed, which would be different than a home area networking test bed.
Yeah.
And by size, if you mean dollar figure, you can range anywhere from at NIST for the meter lab, we were at something under $200,000 to establish that lab. In another utility lab that I was in recently, they were in the $20 million range, right? So that's the lab that was highly isolated for function. So, you can spend a lot of money, but you can also do a lot of work for a relatively small amount of money if you concentrate on how you design it and how you operate it.
Yeah, I think that approach that you showed with the spreadsheet with the uses and the features is a good one, because you first lay it all out and then you start strategizing on how to collect certain types of uses to test out in certain types of test beds.
Well, imagine if you were the manager, and your employee came to you and said, I want to build a test bed. Well, that's no information, right? That's worse than no information. You've given me the burden of making a decision without having any background. Compare that to coming in with a spreadsheet that says, here's the functions I'd like to do, and here's how much it's going to cost, and let's just pick the ones that we can afford to do. Yeah, it's a matter of giving information. We're always dealing with this process of data to information to knowledge to wisdom. We're always trying to get from data up to the level of wisdom. And, something like that spreadsheet actually brings us up to the knowledge level, right, where we actually have information that we can apply to make a good decision. Now, the wisdom level, that's maybe the next level up. That's the next higher pay scale to decide that, I do have this much money to spend to make this happen.
There is one more question. Is the smart grid test bed generally expected to offer access and perform tests over secured internet? I guess they meant secure wide area network connections.
Well, again, it comes down to what is the intended test? So if you're testing distribution automation equipment, you may well have to test against a test version, let's say, of a distribution management system. In our case, our laboratory was remote from our downtown headquarters, right? We didn't have the dispatchers in the same building that the tests were being done in. So we're going to go out over the company's secure wide area network. Now, again, what we're talking about here is controlled environment stage testing. This is not field tests. These are controlled environment tests within a laboratory setting. So you would expect that if you've got a laboratory setting that you are part of the company's wide area network, and that has been secured by your telecom security people. Does that kind of address the question?
I think so. At this time, we don't have any more questions. I would like to open the floor for you, Ray, if you wanted to make any final comments, and then I have some notes at the end of this webinar.
Well, I'd appreciate any feedback. If If I said something that didn't make sense or was not clear, let me know, and I'll make an effort to clarify it. I appreciate everyone's attending. This is a nice format to work from, and just feel free to contact me if there's anything I can do to answer questions or help any of you.
Great. Thank you, Ray. The presentation and the recording will be sent to all those who registered over the next couple of days. Our next presentation is going to be in the second week of September. I'll be sending an announcement, and William Miller is going to be our presenter, and he'll be talking about a particular standard and its where it has reached and which has potential for smart grid applications. The key takeaway from this presentation today is that as you make your decisions of make versus buy for the services of a testbed, have a very good idea of what your business goals are and what your commitment to smart grid is and what schedule you're trying to deliver what services, and that will help you make a decision of what types of testbeds to develop. And this presentation and the workshop behind it actually provides you a methodology by which you can think logically in a structured way and come up with your conclusions. So I appreciate all your participation, and thank you for supporting this forum. And at this time, I will end the recording. Have a very enjoyable afternoon and rest of the week. Thank you.
Thank you all. Thank you, everyone.